Good afternoon and welcome to the third and final part of the 24th annual Helen Clark Berlin Symposium. So happy that you could join us for this wonderful lecture by Professor Evie Terrono. She was the moderator for our panel discussion last night. Who was able to get to that?
Some of you.
So now she is going to deliver the lecture to conclude the symposium. And her talk is entitled Civil War to Civil Rights, How African American Artists Engaged the Past. Professor Terrono joined the faculty of Randolph Macon College in Ashland, Virginia in 1990, where she teaches art history. In her research, Terrono seeks to understand the complexities of the commissions of Civil War monuments and the multifaceted political underpinnings that define their reception then and now. Terrono is interested in the memory and commemoration of the Civil War, its actors and its heroes, and the sites of memory in which contested remembrances of the conflict continue to be reenacted. She has a forthcoming article entitled Great Generals and Christian Soldiers, Commemorations of Robert E. Lee and Stonewall Jackson in a Civil Rights Era, in which she analyzes memorials at Wyman Park in Baltimore and at the National Cathedral, both of which are being reconsidered and challenged today. Please join me in welcoming Professor Terrono.
Wonderful platform, and for really, really enriching our experiences in so many ways. Lynchburg has been a wonderful, wonderful context for us, both intellectually, but also we came to marvel at the culinary landscape here, which is so sophisticated. So thank you so much. It has been a very, very rich, wonderful experience for the last couple of days, interacting with creative minds that challenge us constantly beyond our comfort. And for me personally, it has been a very, very probing exercise because we mine images, we mine context, and I have found wonderful, wonderful human experience in Todd's work and Toyin's work and Karen's work. So I do hope that if you haven't had the opportunity to look at this exhibition, and I mean literally look at it and engage with it deeply, I hope you will be able to do so. As Martha said, my work focuses on memory and commemoration, definitions of race and identity in American art and history, and contested spaces, however they are defined very broadly, either in American landscapes or more specifically in terms of the artistic production. I have an accent. I tell my students that if my Android can understand me, certainly they can. I come from Greece, and one of the first books that I read growing up was Willa Cather's My Antonia, and I was very fascinated and perplexed by this concept of the American dream and its constant pursuit. And what does it mean? Certainly, other people have aspirations comparable to those in America, but there is no such thing as the French dream or the Greek dream. So what are the constitutive parts of the American dream? What is it so exceptional about it? And by exceptional, I mean not only the parameters within one enters it, but also why and how populations are excluded. And as I was talking with the artists on exhibition here, and as we were exchanging ideas about the American experience, I thought I should focus my presentation much more specifically, rather than broadly, to how American artists, African American artists, engage the past, but how do they engage with this notion of the American dream? The concept is very much part and parcel of the American identity, very much part of our daily economic, political, and social discourse, although we may be unfamiliar with its origins and its particulars. James Truslow Adams, in the middle of the Depression in 1931, in The Epic of America, defined it very, very differently than relatively contemporary humorous interpretations. Certainly a contemporary lifestyle, a house in the suburbs, 2.5 kids, and I'm almost there. And then, of course, the privilege of money. But also, of course, more recently, we have experienced its tenuous reality. So in 1931, he said that the American dream is, quote, "the dream of a land in which life should be better and richer and fuller for everyone, with opportunity for each according to ability or achievement." And then he recognized that it's a very difficult dream for the European upper classes to understand, to interpret adequately, he proposed, and too many of us ourselves have grown weary and distrustful of it. And of course, it's interesting to consider those words 80 years later. And he said, it's not a dream of motor cars and higher wages merely, and then he stressed, it is a dream of social order in which each man and each woman shall be able to attain to the fullest nature of which they are innately capable and be recognized by others for what they are, regardless of the fortuitous circumstances of birth or position. At a time of rising economic and social tensions, the achievement of the American dream seemed most remote at the time for African Americans, who endured vicissitudes of exclusion and marginalization at best, and violence and brutalization at worst. Facing jurisdictional disenfranchisement in the South and de facto segregation in the North, African Americans in the 1930s battled against not only economic hardships, but also extreme violence that was often officially sanctioned in the South and perpetuated by the increasing authority of the KKK and the resulting lynchings. These increased throughout the 1920s and the early 1930s, so much so that in February and March of 1935, two anti-lynching exhibitions were held in New York City. And the four works that I'm showing you now have currently been collected. Actually, I just saw them at the Whitney Museum, but because they are prints, they also exist in other collections. In order to sensitize audiences, and primarily white audiences at the time, to the continued atrocities against African Americans, Walter White, and I had the opportunity to visit the Ann Spencer House yesterday, and I realized that Walter White was one of the visitors in Lynchburg, which is a fascinating history, was instrumental in organizing one of these exhibitions entitled A Commentary on Lynching, all the while trying to revive anti-lynching legislation at the time by seeking support for the Costigan Wagner Bill, which was introduced in Congress in 1934. One should also remember that it was very much within this landscape of intimidation and violence, and certainly the artists who participated in these two anti-lynching exhibitions were not only African American, but also white, and Reginald Marsh is the name that you might be familiar with. One should also remember that these were the years that Margaret Mitchell's 1936 novel, Gone with the Wind, was released to enthusiastic audiences who flocked to embrace what was clearly a highly mythologized and highly romanticized version of the devastation brought upon the Civil War. And certainly it introduced and also validated this very positive and benevolent interaction between the faithful slave and the benevolent master, and became, of course, wildly popular in 1939 when the film was released. And it established very much this prototype of what is often referred to as plantation nostalgia, a very valid and very useful paradigm, a kind of mythological paradigm that was meant to neutralize contemporary realities and contemporary forced racial conflict. In that same year, 1939, when the film was released, another story that you might be altogether familiar, Marian Anderson was denied access to the Hall of the Daughters of the American Revolution and instead was given permission to perform at the Lincoln Memorial, singing "My Country, 'Tis of Thee, Sweet Land of Liberty." It was indeed this message of liberty that Martin Luther King would pick up in August of 1963, when he called on his audiences from those same steps of the Lincoln Memorial to hew out a mountain of despair, a stone of hope, and to transform the discords of our nation into a beautiful symphony of brotherhood. It is against these fraught historical realities that African American artists question the notion of the American dream and the challenges towards its achievement in the 20th century. And well into our own time. Since the 19th century, certainly African American artists have proposed a constant dialogue with their contemporary environment, as well as the American past, in an effort to provide evidence and context for the shaping of American identities. But contemporary African American artists have reframed this dialogue, and I'm showing you here the work of Fred Wilson, an artist to whose work I will return, and have challenged hegemonic perspectives, both of high art. In his case, he takes found objects, very much like some of the artists in this exhibition, and retextualizes them in order to provide corrective or more inclusive narratives and viewpoints of the American historical past. So for the remaining time I have with you today, I would like to focus on the ways in which American artists have engaged us with the concept of the American dream, this dream of inclusion, self-sufficiency, self-determination, in an effort not only to record, but also to call us into action against the injustices that have happened historically and as our artists have addressed, continue to provide frameworks of marginalization. Certainly, 19th century artists created relatively optimistic images that celebrated newly acquired liberties, and I'm showing you Edmonia Lewis, perhaps one of the most celebrated African-American artists who worked primarily in Italy, her Forever Free, this of course at the beginning of a Reconstruction, and then the reappraisal of the same theme by Sargent Johnson in the 1930s. In her work, Edmonia Lewis shows the young black man, now free, with his young wife, looking upwards into the heavens, but as you see, he's partially clothed, indicating this kind of liminality. And of course, in the 19th century, clothing was a signifier of the civilized body, so he's not bound to his condition of slavery. He has broken his shackles, but he's not quite part of the American polity. In the 1930s, Sargent shifts the dialogue, focuses our attention exclusively on the young mother whose children are literally wrapped around her. The gaze is very much directed upwards to kind of divine protection, but there is a sense of implicit threat, and I'm suggesting, of course, that this functions very much within the racial realities of the 1930s and the threat and intimidation. The promise that is implicit in this work, certainly one would suggest, came to be realized with the New Negro Movement, made popular in the writings of Alan Locke, according to whom, of course, the New Negro defied categorization, a concept that has emerged a number of times in our discussion. Black identities are not monolithic. They are very diverse. They are multi-layered. They are multifaceted. And he suggested this, as you see, very early on in the 1920s. And he also demanded new criteria for the evaluation of what constituted black identities. And I'm citing here his proposal that new social scientists were incapable of categorizing black identities, black people, exactly because they no longer were able to fit into the framework of the enslaved, but they had no criteria, they had no language as to how to incorporate them into the American experience. He also proposed, of course, that African Americans have to define their own identities from within rather than adopt the perspective of the white establishment. Certainly, images of self-determination and racial uplift towards the realization of the American dream were paramount in the work of artists in the context of the Harlem Renaissance in the 1920s, and I'm showing you here the work of Aaron Douglas, and later on we're going to look at Jacob Lawrence, who incorporated in their work not only new aesthetic principles demonstrating their firm understanding of modernism. Todd earlier on talked about this appropriation of cubism, and interestingly enough, I'm going to return to it as well. But also, most importantly, a new identity of African American men and women who were urban, self-fashioned, and upwardly mobile. And in his work here entitled Aspiration, Douglas reminded his audiences certainly of the mournful beginnings of slavery at the bottom, but also delineated very dynamic characters of both men and women dependent on education and technology as they are gazing sort of the city on the hill, which was such a standard metaphor for personal redemption and certainly racial uplift among the black community. Similarly, in his Building More Stately Nations, their remembrance of their past, their African heritage, fuels their ambitions to build more stately mansions. And I chose this work because I'm going to return to this theme, as you're going to see in a few minutes, in the work of Kerry Marshall. Again, dependent on education and justifying W.E.B. Du Bois' rather well-known quote, expressed in 1903, for self-expression and self-development. So this concept emerges in Amon Locke, it emerges in W.E.B. Du Bois, and certainly is realized in the work of many of the artists that I'm going to talk about today. Espousing these ideals and his emphasis on education rather than menial and manual work as the path to integration and towards social and economic ascendancy, many artists, including, of course, Jacob Lawrence, privileged the authority that that knowledge brought about for African Americans in his simply patterned, easy to understand, engaging works of the black experience. Lawrence condensed the hardships of his people out of slavery and away from the oppressive Southern experience, but also their struggles towards an ambiguous and conditional future in the North. In Lawrence's work, as much as in that of his contemporaries, there is a recognition of the qualities that are constitutive of the American dream: economic stability, material prosperity, individuality. And whereas certainly Lawrence's work reveals, as you see on the left, some of the antagonisms that were present even within the African-American community on the part of established African-Americans in the North, James Vanderzee's photograph celebrates the achievements of the young couple who were very confidently posed in front of their car, and again, this is 1933, that showcased very much their stylish embrace of the signs of what one would identify as the middle class American dream. And the viewer certainly cannot be but intrigued that is an engagement. We were talking yesterday about the power of the gauge. They are looked up on, but at the same time, they very actively interrogate the gaze of the camera and potentially, of course, of all of us. Certainly, these are images of self-sufficiency, and we see echoes of that, as well as the authority that the images project in Gordon Parks' Husband and Wife at Fort Scott, Kansas. Last year, there was a spectacular exhibition at the High Museum in Atlanta that brought together Gordon Parks' work and the underlying narratives of his work. And in this particular case, of course, we have a head-on view which invites us very much to contemplate the minute landscape of the faces. Dr. Campbell brought up this notion of a face as landscape yesterday, when she said it, I thought, oh my gosh, she's reading my mind as to what I'm going to talk about tomorrow. And there is certainly a sense of intimacy in the direct gaze, but at the same time, there is a kind of reservation. The emphasis, of course, is on their authority, their spirituality, they're going to church, we know the story. But I would propose that there is something very different in this work than the kind of optimism to some extent that we saw in Van der Zee's photograph. A kind of reserved countenance of both of the subjects in Park's photo. And I would propose that this is very much reflective in the 1940s of the high contentions that marked the Black experience in this period, and which are very broadly and very eloquently marked in Park's work, and which become much more evident in this iconic work that I would imagine is very well known to many of you. In the majority, though, of his historically significant works, Parks did not record the upward mobility of his fellow blacks, but rather the challenges, this notion of the ever-elusive quality of the American dream, and particularly in this truly iconic but also ironic image in 1942, entitled, as we see, American Gothic, and I'm bringing up, of course, the image that he paraphrases. And he created certainly one of the most insightful and engaging records of abject poverty in the nation's capital. And I'm quoting his perspective because it's very, very telling of how he, as a black person, understood the condition of the black experience in the times. In an interview for PBS NewsHour in 1998, he referred to his own experience in Washington, D.C., and he said, "I had experienced a kind of bigotry and discrimination here that I had never expected to experience, and I photographed her after everyone had left the building. At first, I asked her about her life, what it was like, and it was so disastrous," he says, "that I felt that I must photograph this woman in a way that would make me feel, or make the public feel, about what Washington, D.C. was like in 1942. So I put her before the American flag with a broom in one hand and a mop in another, and I said, 'American Gothic.' That's what I felt about America and Emma Watson's position within this country." For many, the photographs of Parks in the mid-20th century have come to identify the tenuous experience of African Americans who became increasingly invisible, marginalized in the the American fabric, as Ralph Ellison exposed in 1952 in one of the seminal studies of discrimination in the civil rights era, the homonym novel, of course, The Invisible Man. And here I'm showing you Gordon Parks' interpretation of the novel. You see the subtitle says, "Photographer recreates the emotional crisis of a powerful new novel." In this novel, if you have not read, particularly those of you who, I see there are young people in the audience, very, very much, very worth reading. The protagonist comes from the South, where he's confronted with white authoritarianism and discrimination, and then he decides to move north to fight for civil rights, but then he realizes, of course, that very much this reality follows him, and he's constantly undermined, and his perspectives are compromised. And ultimately, he's unable to claim his position in society. And this, for Ellison, was very much autobiographical, was very much self-reflective, and at some point he said, "I'm invisible, understand? Simply, people refuse to see me." And yesterday again, during our conversation, Toyin talked about this notion of absolute blackness, both in pictorial terms, but also in terms of one's identity where there is a complete disregard for the other, exactly because one is not able to go beyond the materiality of the blackness of the skin. Morris Berger has noted in his study of visual culture and the struggle for civil rights that in Ellison's worldview, the war against racism is in great part a fight to overcome society's pervasive need to obscure or obliterate the realities of race. Again, another thing that we discussed yesterday. In his many photographs, particularly of the urban experience, Hart noted that his work was a weapon, the means by which to combat prejudice, exclusion, marginalization, right, victimization. But when one turns to his much more mundane interpretations of life, which he created for Life magazine beginning in the early 1950s, he exposes the very everyday banality of the middle class experience, as in this particular case, of course, the subjects are in their best clothing in front of the department store or the soda, the ice cream store. Whereas we focus perhaps on their pictorial beauty, the narrative of the discriminatory signs punctuates in, particularly in this case, you know, the neon intensity reinforces the Jim Crow authority. Increasingly, the responses of African American artists as well as that of white artists to black exclusion and victimization became much more graphic, much more explicit, and certainly highly politicized beginning in the 1960s, and as we see this exhibition as, and as I'm going to conclude, much, much more graphic. Realizing the potential of the image to sensitize, agitate, and encourage audiences towards action, black and white artists in the civil rights era confronted the social and political realities, truly using their art as weapons against intolerance and bigotry, aiming though to engage rather than alienate the audiences, many of whom, of course, stood in solidarity, and that's why I choose Andy Warhol. White certainly embraced the civil rights movement, and particularly in this geographic context. Some of you might know that all too well. The response of African American artists was often very much dependent on the appropriation of symbols, and this is another concept that we talked about yesterday, that stood for the foundational principles of American democracy and civil liberties, as in this case, Faith Ringles, the Flag is Bleeding of 1967, in which both black and white bodies are united towards a common cause under the protection of the blood-spattered flag, but this appears more as a barrier rather than as a privilege. Significant legal protections extended to African Americans in the 1950s and 1960s through the Brown versus the Board of Education in 1954, the Civil Rights Act in 1964, and the Voting Rights Act of 1965 certainly outlawed discrimination, but at the same time, increased the divide as white populations resisted integration. The evident signs of threat and intimidation confronting six-year-old Ruby Ridges, the N-word, and then of course KKK here. On her way to school became part and parcel of a systematic and widespread system of denial to education, certainly organized and legitimized discrimination and violence. Yesterday, Kevin recognized the influence of David Hammons in his work. David Hammons was a relatively young artist in the 1960s. He created some of the most radical, very provocative, self-referential works where he literally imprinted his body onto the materials. He would lay the canvas on the floor and then then literally cover himself in paint. So his DNA, his selfhood, his identity was projected onto his work. So in this particular case, he's commenting, of course, on the educational restrictions as literally his body is slammed against the admissions office of the university. Claude Clark, one of the most politicized artists of the era and a contemporary, suggested in a letter to David Driscoll, who is a very prominent black art historian, that his work represents not only the condition, but names the enemy and directs, as he proposed, towards a plan of action in search of our own roots, but ultimately eventual liberation. Certainly, popular magazines from the 1940s, the 1950s, and 1960s privileged a distinctly black perspective, exposed discrimination, and provided dignified and uplifting images and messages about the black reality and the black experience. But at the same time, and you see in this case, I'm showing you this cover because Charles White's drawings were included and the title implies, of course, a dignified perspective. But whereas the black press privileged and identified this perspective, advertising media certainly proliferated these images that advanced the kind of stereotypes of servitude and willing compliance. The persistent commodification of blackness, yet another idea that we explored yesterday in contemporary advertisements, brought home the most prominent and very persistent enduring paradigms of black subservience, those of Aunt Jemima prevalent among them, whose kindly and benign manner and subjective nature kept them in their place, if you will, as the antidote to very aggressive political realities, particularly in the 1940s, 1950s, and increasingly, of course, at mid-century in the 1960s. Adopted as a symbol for the pancake product in 1890, it went through a number of reincarnations and reiterations, and it was revived, of course, in the 1930s, became a very valid symbol because, of course, again, this is the same time that this plantation nostalgia was reinforced with Gone with the Wind. The persistence of the accommodationist and non-threatening image of Aunt Jemima was seriously, of course, challenged by contemporary political realities. And I had a conversation yesterday with Dr. Dunferman about their realities in Danville, and he brilliantly enlarged my perspectives, referring to a much earlier civil rights experience. But nevertheless, this was the context within which these images were absorbed. And here, of course, the demonstrations in Danville, and then, of course, the sit-ins in Richmond at the Tollheimer stores. African Americans saw in the friendly image of Aunt Jemima their past and present writ large in the hands, of course, of the commercial advertisers. And certainly Aunt Jemima had featured prominently in a number of world's fairs throughout the 1930s, although by the 1940s, the NAACP had resisted this image. They fought very intensely to obliterate it from the, certainly the public sphere and from white memory. Local chapters of the NAACP actually began pressuring schools and fair organizers not to invite Aunt Jemima to appear, and because she came to stand as the most public and most visible representation of blackness, whereas, of course, the idea was to promote political agency. For African American artists, however, Aunt Jemima became the most powerful symbol of resistance. Certainly in quest for self-sufficiency, self-determination, in the pursuit of this elusive path to inclusion. In the hands of Betty Saar, John Lockhart, and Jeff Donaldson, as you're going to see in a few minutes, she became literally the figurehead of a militant, assertive African-American community. Both male and female artists resisted the personal and collective objectification implicit in Aunt Jemima, and through their broad appropriation of her image, refashioned her identity to express the anxieties, but also the ideologies of the time. And certainly in the hands of Jeff Donaldson, a founding member of the group AfriCobra, a very militant group of artists in the 1960s, whose aesthetic was very much indicative of their political activism. And you see in this case, according to Donaldson, he literally began this work the day of the Civil Rights March in Washington. Aunt Jemima is no longer the passive Mamie, but is very much this androgynous kind of figure who is battling the kind of militaristic Pillsbury Doughboy against this chevron-like reinterpretation of the American flag. Betty Saar's work, of course, might be much more familiar to many, many of you, very highly nuanced. It's essentially an assemblage, a combination of mixed media and very small scale work, where she took, as you see, the notepad. This is a found object. She took the notepad, took out the white pages, and inscribed within it, again, this very stereotypical interpretation of the black woman holding on one hand, of course, the child. But this is no longer a benign, nurturing image of Jemima, but a very militant one, because as you see, of course, she's holding a gun and then a pistol. And from the mist rises the fist of black power. So out of the cotton experience comes this remarkable radicalism. At the same time, of course, that she situates her work within the larger context of the Pan-African experience. The validity of this stereotype and its power to engage audiences to its multivalent meanings persists certainly to our own day, when artists as diverse as Fred Wilson and Renee Cox confront our sensibilities with the familiarity of the images by pointing certainly to the prejudicial perspective and agitate our comfort with their continued use. Here Renee Cox, one of the most caustic contemporary artists, literally leads Aunt Jemima and Uncle Ben out of their boundaries, out of their commodified identity. They are very powerful figures, although please bear in mind her work is not without its challenges, and indeed critics have suggested that by portraying the black body, particularly the partially unclothed black body, she capitalizes on existing racial stereotypes. The subtlety of irony and political activism that is evident in the work of Betty Saar and of other African-American artists has been supplanted in the work of their contemporary counterparts by much more graphic and confrontational approaches. Contemporary African-American artists who deal with racial issues engage with broad critiques of high versus low art, and we are surrounded by examples of that. In the case of Kevin Bisley, for example, his materials in themselves are not artistic per se, but he invests them with remarkable pregnant meaning. But certainly contemporary artists have challenged the very strict parameters. They have proposed autobiographical elements. For those of you who were here this morning, Todd Gray was narrating, of course, how he projects autobiography onto his works. And they all propose, of course, very radical critique of institutional boundaries. And again, Todd Gray, in his excerpt, which is on the wall but also part of the catalog, suggests that his work and his approach is a constant
questioning of systems, whether they are academic systems, whether they are museum systems, whether they are social systems, economic systems, and that's where I would like to take us for the next minutes. They question, of course, not only systems of power, but certainly market capitalism, and encourage particular ideological perspectives that reframe the dialogue. Their art is very often cerebral. It interrupts or denies an easy or immediate engagement between the viewer and the artwork, and we had discussions through these last couple of days as to how the artists project their work, and then of course what we all as the viewers bring onto this narrative, how do we understand the work. But the emphasis is obviously on exposing contemporary truths of urban isolation and marginality and the lack of equal access. Born in Birmingham, Alabama, as you have been seeing here, Carrie Marshall and Toyin Onyetola's work is very aware of Carrie Marshall's work, and her work creates an ongoing dialogue with his. His work actually was the subject of a spectacular exhibition 2 years ago at the National Gallery. Moved, as you see, with his family to Watts, California, and as he says here, it is impossible to move to Watts in 1963 and not speak about it. That determined, he said, a lot of where my work was going to go, certainly autobiographical, at the same time, of course, that it expresses broader thematic concerns. A re-emerging theme in Marshall's work is this kind of anonymity of the lived experience, this invisibility, which I proposed earlier on, departing with Ellison's novel. And very often the subject of his work are housing projects that bear, as you see, rather optimistic names, Nickerson Gardens, but conceal the isolation, the alienation, and the depravity, or the deprivation, I'm sorry, that one may experience in them. Nickerson Gardens and other large housing projects feature prominently in his work, and in this particular case, Nickerson Gardens was the largest urban development in public housing west of the Mississippi, but was also the site of much violence in the civil rights era as a result of California's Proposition 14 that blocked the fair housing portion of the Civil Rights Act. In August of 1965, so we just commemorate this tragic anniversary with our current racial conflicts, 5 years of devastating rioting resulted in the loss of 34 lives, the wounding of hundreds, and literally the destruction of the community. The deceptive cheerfulness of Marshall's work conceals the loss of hope and promise that define very much the Black experience in the obliterating uniformity of these massive urban spaces. The cheery brightness of the flowers in the foreground are very much reflected in the sun in the background, and the cartoonish ribbon, and my apologies, as you see my slide is cut off, in the background suggests that there is more of everything here. Alongside the fluttering ribbon that the birds are carrying that says, "Here we rest." Against this almost surreal landscape, however, the teenager lying in the immediate foreground confronts our understanding of the word, confounds our understanding of the word, and confuses the notion of resting as relaxing, and certainly the funereal implications of everlasting rest as the outcome of police intervention during the Watts riots. Similarly, in the background of many mansions, again a theme that Aaron Douglas, as we saw, explored earlier on,
loom the angular modern towers of the projects Illinois 222, which appears in bright red. And again, we have a kind of Arcadian landscape in the background of picturesque fences and manicured bushes that imply an almost idyllic existence, again made even more pronounced by the banners up on top, "Bless our happy home." This peaceful fiction, however, is interrupted by the red ribbon, I'm sorry, the blue birds here. This peaceful, though, implication is interrupted by the ribbon up on top that reads essentially as a deviation of the biblical passage that says, "In my father's house," from the book of John. In this particular case, it reads, "In my mother's house," there are many mansions. Certainly the warmth, the reference expresses the warmth of the home and offers a promise of happiness, but it may also refer to the authority of the mother rather than the absent father in many low-income families. The evident ambiguity of the action of the figures in the foreground, they're dressed in the Sunday best, but they're doing yard work, creates a remarkable tension as we are uncertain whether they are tending gardens or funeral plots. The intensity of the blackness of the men, what Kerry Marshall has called unequivocally black, a concept stemming from his fascination with Ellison's Invisible Men, makes their lack of authority even more pronounced. We don't see them as individuals, we see them just as signifiers of a whole racial construction. At the same time, however, Marshall's work carried on occasion an optimistic message of community and belonging, as in this case, Our Time, which describes the innocence and joy of childhood and perhaps the realization of the American promise as the children go through the neighborhood, or in this particular case, in Bang, they pledge allegiance to the flag, celebrating their freedom on July 4th, and they're suggesting we are one, however ambiguous this oneness might be. The tenuous achievement of this implied unity and the incorporation into the American fabric is certainly challenged in the work of one of the most provocative contemporary artists, Michael Ray Charles, where sinister stereotypes reemerge as a validation of their continued currency in our contemporary society. Although other artists, most notably Bessart, have criticized very much this appropriation and revalidation of the stereotype, Charles suggests that he is upsetting the canonical reading of the stereotypical perspective, creating a conundrum as to their interpretation. And he comes back to this concept of forever free in a number of his works, as in this particular case, Forever Free, Affirmative Fears, Affirmative Tears. And as he said in an interview for PBS's R21, he says, "A lot of blacks have accused me of perpetuating stereotypes," because as I said, the artistic community has been very critical of his work. But he's suggesting that he likes to create this tension, to evoke thought, and to have people question how we deal with these images, because of course he's referring to the kind of imagery that is very much embedded into the national memory. And if you haven't had the chance to watch the bridge video, you will see that this is one of the narratives that emerges. The contradictory reception of Charles' work, in this case, I'm showing you another stereotype that I will talk about for the next few minutes, praised by many and certainly maligned by others, speaks to the discomfort one rightly feels, I would hope we feel, in front of his works, but one certainly does not stay apathetic, and that's exactly his proposition. He wants to
disrupt the narrative, he wants to upset our comfort with greater subtlety perhaps, but no less intensity. Hank Willis Thomas, whose work, I'm sorry to say, is obscured by the screen here, proposes similar perspectives. And Toyin yesterday talked about, one of my questions was this qualification of blackness, the branding of black identities, and we have not talked about what we are each going to say, but it was a wonderful conduit to my discussion today. He created this series called Branded, in which he digitally engraved the Nike logo on different parts of his male black nude model, making explicit references to the insidious, of course, branding of slaves. Thomas also addresses a broader concern as to the continued commodification of the black body and the advertising and the branding campaigns deliberately geared towards minority groups, particularly black audiences, hoping that they would like to acquire the external trappings of social and economic ascendancy. Central to Willis's exploration is this constant dialoguing with his own history, with a national history, with this notion of the black body as spectacle, as the object of our gaze. And in this particular case, he's obviously referring to the Cotton Bowl, where the black football player is confronting his ancestor collecting cotton across literally the divide of the field lines. His emphasis on the black athletic bodies who garner commercial and editorial attention is often seen as a guaranteed ticket from anonymity and poverty to fame for young blacks, but it also addresses the historical inequities of the exploitation of the laboring body for the benefit of others. And particularly, of course, the title of this series, Strange Fruit, brings clear allusions, of course, to the poem and the very well-known song by Billie Holiday that brings forth the spectatorial nature of lynchings, during which audiences gathered to watch and be photographed along with a lynched body. In his commentary, Thomas recognizes the intentionality of the historical narrative and asserts that, quote, black bodies are spectacles, and in the NCAA, NBA, NFL drafts and combines, this history is continually reenacted. Their ancestors, he proposed, may have worked the cotton and tobacco fields that later became football fields. Their ancestors may have been lynched. I'm really trying to draw people out to talk about the very likely possibilities of this continued marginalization so that we can think more critically about the present experience. And then he concludes, exploitation is what our country was founded on, it's the American way, we should be more upfront about it. The NCAA is a multi-billion, he says, dollar business built primarily off the free labor of descendants of slaves, by bargain. The fact that many African American artists continue to engage with the historical reality speaks certainly to their persistent currency as they're negotiating not only the vestiges of the past, but as we see all around us, express contemporary concerns, the ambiguities of the artistic presence within their racialized experience of the 21st century. The exploitation and appropriation of black labor as well as of individual invisibility is a recurring theme that many of the artists in this exhibition have explored. Also is present in Fred Wilson's work. This morning, Todd talked about the appropriation of black labor, and again, it was a very fortuitous frame for my own discussion. Fred Wilson challenges the ways we interact with highbrow museum culture. He suggested in other contexts that he literally uses the museum as his palette. He mines the collections of museums and then creates a meta-narrative. He advances our understanding of what the artworks are by providing a new frame of reference. In this multi-layered work entitled Guarded View, Wilson adds layers of signification that create a charged interaction between the visual and the verbal, the observer and the observed, using, of course, the very iconic painting of Picasso's Demoiselles d'Avignon, clearly a paradigmatic work. I can't imagine that there's a person in this room that doesn't know it. He comments on the appropriation of non-Western, specifically, of course, African art in this case, and Todd referred to that this morning, that Picasso used to revitalize and regenerate his work by certainly divorced the work from its sociocultural ritualistic function, and he literally mined it essentially from the perspective of a colonizer without bothering to understand its significance. Then, as it would be appropriate for such a masterpiece, Fred Wilson places a line of guards in front of the work to guarantee its safety, and our guarded view of the view, as our interaction with any work of art is always supervised and perhaps limited by the authority of the museum guards. In an ironic vein, however, those guards, all of whom are people